Welcome to ASU and the Center for Service Leadership. My name is Thomas Hallman. I am the Executive Director of the Center. And welcome to our series, A Conversation With. Our guest on this edition of A Conversation With is Ture Tuunanen. Ture is Professor of Information Systems at the University of Jyväskylä. I got that just about right.
Yeah, very good.
And in Finland. And he is a leader of the services discipline. A great guy and a very good friend of the center. Ture, thank you for joining me on our webinar.
Thank you for inviting me. Thank you.
And we also have Denise Feiring with us. Denise is our manager for marketing communications and programming in the center. Denise will handle audience questions as we move along. Now, I would like to start by learning a little bit about you. And let's start at the very beginning. Where did you grow up?
In a small rural town in the west part of Finland called Kauhova. About 8,000 people, and I actually spent my childhood and teenage there until I joined the military when I was 19. So it's a conscription army back in Finland. So I moved back from home at the point of then. I've been living around the world since that. So
that's right. We'll talk about your career path and your around the world part of that for sure. So let's talk a little bit about the beginnings of your career. How and where did you get started? Industry, academia, how did that all play out?
Well, it's a funny story in a way that during my university studies, I actually established 2-3 companies. So nowadays I would be called as a startup entrepreneur. We didn't have that word at the times, but I set up small companies and I had In one of them had 10 people actually working with me, and at some point I wanted to go back and finish my master's studies at the time, and I really at that point it was the dot-com boom era as well, so a lot of mobile services was coming to these devices that we used at the time, and I got really excited doing research on understanding how mobile services could be designed better and how to understand customer requirements. And I ended up doing a PhD at the Helsinki School of Economics, which is nowadays part of Aalto University, and it's called Aalto University School of Business. So it has changed the name a few times in between, but that's sort of the origins of my story, perhaps.
Great. So, as I said, both industry and academia are part of your background, and entrepreneurial ideas flow through your veins.
So yeah, I'm actually a third-generation entrepreneur, so... Well, my grandfather was one, my dad was one, and I'm still one. So yes. I still have a couple of firms that I work with. I'm a chairman of the board at the moment. So
one of the few academics that is also very active on the industry side.
Yeah.
And so that's among many reasons why we thought that a conversation with you would be really wonderful and fun for both our faculty network and our industry members as well. Now, you have had a long career in academia. And can you take us briefly on an overview journey of your career development in academia?
Yeah. So I did my master's degree at the Helsinki School of Economics. I also continued with my doctoral studies in the same place. It's interesting that I actually started in the Department of Marketing. And then I actually realized when I was talking with Christian Möller, one of the marketing folks back at the time, and Christian did a lot of research in business networks, and I was really keen on these mobile services, and I noticed that there's a couple of professors in information systems that are working on these topics, and I started a conversation with Christian that how about if I would actually do my PhD in the information systems, and I moved there after, and then started working with my PhD, and then got that done 2005, actually in 3 years' time, which the medium time at the time was close to 5-6 years, like it's regular here in US. And after my PhD, I started as a senior lecturer in University of Auckland Business School. So that was the opposite side of the world from Finland. So
I don't know if you go through the center of the earth from Finland, you might come out in New Zealand, I guess.
So that's more or less. So that's sort of the beginnings of the thing. And I spent 4 or 5 years in New Zealand. I had a great time, really great university, and then met my wife during my travels, and then we decided to go back to Europe. I ended up in Finland. She's nowadays in Stockholm, and long making the long story short, I've been U.S. for the past 7 years now.
Great. And your personal journey is an interesting one for those of us in the services research and academic side, because from the beginning in the services discipline, we have seen and really desired the field to be interdisciplinary. So we've always, in the service discipline, been very keen on and very much trying as much as we could to have it as an interdisciplinary field. Because, of course, services are very interdisciplinary. You can't really do just marketing in a silo or just finance or just HR in a silo. You really got to do it all together. So you started marketing, then went to the information system side. How did you personally then get involved with the services field?
That was a little bit by chance. A little bit by chance. I was working there in the Department of Information Systems and Operations Management in Auckland, and next door was Department of Marketing and Rod Prodi. And Rod took an interest on my work and me perhaps, and Rod pushed me towards services. And I actually met him with one of these conferences that we have a quiz. And Rod was there, and I actually said to him when I met him for I haven't seen him for a few years. I said, "Rod, you are to blame that I'm in services," because he was really sort of mentoring me towards this, and that way I also end up here after a few years as well. So I blame Rod
Well, that's good.
in a way,
It's all his fault, yeah. No,
but
he's a great guy too.
yeah,
We
he's a super
he's
guy.
also a good friend of the center as well. And maybe a message or a lesson for all of our academic listeners. If you run into people in your hallways in your university, make them become service people, no matter where they are right now. So
That's a good advice.
they will like it, and they will adjust to it easily. And we need it in the service field, very disciplinary as well. Now, you joined the faculty network of the Center for Services Leadership here at ASU, I believe in 2009. Tell me about how you became involved with the center and your experience with the center.
Yeah, I actually visited the ASU for a couple of years before that, and I met with Mary Jo and others many times, and it happens also that my wife was doing a PhD at economics here, so I was spending a significant amount of time here in the Tempe and Scottsdale area. And at some point, Mary Jo said that when, "Well, Tore, since you're here and you're interested in services, why don't you consider coming part of the center as a global fellow?" And I was, of course, very sort of keen to do that, because I really like the center and all the people involved in that. So that was sort of the introduction to the center, and I've been a member for 10 years. I actually realized that from LinkedIn posting that sort of notified me that Tore have been a adjunct professor at ASU for 10 years now. Why don't we celebrate? And yeah, it has a while back, and I've been regularly coming here, spending a couple of months of the year here at the area, and meeting with you guys, and it has been really fascinating to sort of see the center grow still, and even getting better and better, and meeting people and being part of the different events. And now we are starting a research project
That's right.
together
We'll
as well,
talk
which
about
is,
that in a little bit. So
we'll
that's
talk about that in a
the
bit.
arc of how we are getting involved, yeah. Getting you involved and getting our faculty network members involved as well. In addition to New Zealand, of course, you also have a lot of experience in Europe and in the US. Do you see differences how each of those look at services?
I guess so. I'm perhaps looking at this from the information systems point of view, which is my sort of home discipline, and I definitely see how the scholars in our field view differently services. In Europe, it's more sort of looking at the digital services still now, and perhaps at least until a couple of years back, it was in the U.S. It was more about operations side of things, and looking at sort of call center style things, Whereas in Europe, the focus perhaps more have been to innovative digital services and developing them, especially in the German research community. They have been really building stuff with the industry. And that would be perhaps the biggest sort of difference. It's sort of coming together nowadays more and more, but there's still sort of nuances that US might be more on the operations side.
Mm-hmm.
And that could be because there's a lot of people who are coming from the operations management side of things to the service field. So they are sort of course, studying and doing
Right.
things that are familiar, more familiar than, whereas in Europe, it has been very perhaps more techy. In that sense, yeah.
It's also in Europe, from just general perception and the general experience as well, industry is far more involved in
Oh
universities than it is here, certainly in the business school, in terms of grants, and we'll talk about the grant we're working on, but grants and beyond, we have a lot of people that we know in the services field that actually have dual appointments that are still working for, say, an IBM, but also or a professor in the business school. That's much less common here.
Yeah, typically in major research projects, there's going to be companies involved as partners in the projects. And the European Union research funding actually demands us to integrate and involve firms in the bigger grants.
It's a requirement.
It's a requirement.
Of applying for the
grants.
Yes.
And for us in the IS field of information systems, it fits very well because we actually do want to do stuff that impacts the organizations and the society, and we are creating typically systems or services, designing them. So without the interaction with firms, it would be more laboratory experiments, whereas we do want to sort of make an impact to the real world, as to say. But yeah, that's a big difference, and it's typically even for teaching, for my own classes, I typically have in each of the courses several industry speakers coming in and telling about the experiences to our students, and even companies are even bringing cases to the firm, to the classes, that okay, let's try to work on this and try to get some resources. So the industry collaboration, it's perhaps easier. But back in Europe, I don't know what might be the origins of that, but we definitely enjoy that.
Certainly
that
also for the doctoral students that are listening in, it's a very different environment in Europe than here, where here the doctoral students in their 5-year or so program are, of course, getting ready to be faculty somewhere, and so you're doing all the research, whereas in Europe, there's a much larger number of doctoral students, and a very high percentage of them actually are planning to go into industry.
Yes.
And so they are working with industry, and that's something that here is lacking and could maybe be helpful.
Actually, Thomas, funny that you mentioned that. I remember from my doctoral student times that we had a class of 50 students in my school, so the cohort size was 50 whole school, and I think the doctoral school's leader said that one of you will end up as a professor. Well, I'm that. But most of the graduates went to industry, and that was the deal with in information systems in general. That you know we had quite a lot of PhDs graduating, but almost all of them went to work with Accenture or some of the other consulting companies, or Nokia, or Konen nowadays, the elevator company. So it's still the trend that many of our graduates from UVascular also do that. So a few of us stay in academia, but many go to industry.
It definitely creates a different type of conversation within both sides.
Yeah.
Within industry, when you've got this stream of people that are PhD trained coming in, and on the academy side as well.
Yeah.
Let's take a moment and see if we have an audience question. Denise, please go ahead.
Yes, so Thomas, earlier you mentioned in the conversation about how in the initial stages, services discipline tended to be siloed, and really that wasn't something that for the future of services would make sense. How do you see that silos became less of a part of that discipline, and where do you see the future in integration between different disciplines in the services area?
Oh, that's an
easy one. Yeah,
that's an easy one. That's a really, really cool question. Thank you for whoever did that. I think there's multiple answers to that question. I see that, for example, the General Service Research does a great job on trying to sort of bring in this cross-disciplinary culture to the journal, which actually it's key to make people's career work out. If you think about the academic's career, that one of the important things is to publish top quality papers. And then without journals that actually do that, it's very difficult. That's why the silos actually merge, that you're sort of looking at certain set of outlets that you want to publish for your getting your tenure or whatnot, and that sort of limits the options. So there's a lot of responsibility with the academic leaders, not in the universities, but in the academic community, sort of make that happen. And I have been really happy to sort of see that the service community has really tried to make that change happen. There's dedicated journals like Service Science, which is more operation management related research, but well, and then our flagship journal, JSR, the Journal of Service Research. And it really sort of pushes for cross-disciplinary research. So that would be sort of a quick answer to that. But I have to admit that we are still, that's still work in progress, and that requires a lot of work from the deans of the faculties. I actually became the dean of research 1st of January, so it's a lot of pressure on my shoulders to make that happen. And we certainly in UVascular, we are trying to sort of open up those silos and try to sort of see how we can support people who are doing interesting things, which is not fitting to one discipline, but we try to encourage to cross-disciplinary work. Right. And that's one of the things I try to do back home.
It's a big one, an important one on the publishing side, the counting off, just even the counting off non-core. So if you're a marketing faculty, you've got your core marketing journals, then you have journals that are not marketing journals, and counting that within tenure promotion and so on. And
some schools have more flexible systems that they have, for example, a certain journal list coming from inside of the school or by academic community, and they count all the journals in that list. Or then you have a set of departmental lists that are, for example, just marketing journals. And these are sort of decisions that the faculties have to make. And we are certainly sort of doing this kind of work in UVascular already, but lots of things to be done still.
Lots of work to be done. Now, the good thing I find with the service discipline is always that was always welcome from the start when I went in and when you went in, and you know, in the 90s for sure, and before that too, that was very welcome. And certainly from the main conferences, both CRIS, Frontiers, and the other conference, the CERPSIC conference, very inviting to everybody outside of marketing for sure. And also our center, so in our faculty network, we've got a number of people who are not marketing people. So we're trying to get tourism as an example. We've got some operations researchers. We've got design researchers. Yeah. We've got IS researchers. So trying to bring the community together. It's a long haul because the underlying problem is the notion of promotion and tenure and what counts.
Yeah.
But it's a worthwhile fight. And certainly on the industry side, to our industry members, a lot of our industry members are very varied in their backgrounds in terms of operations, in terms of just the kind of things they work on. And so that's another way that we can do that, where as a center we can bring people together. We'll come back to more questions later, but we'll advance the conversation on a number of great topics on service and technology. And I'd like to run a little bit, sort of a very, very shortened timeline in history, I guess.
Okay.
But just get to sort of the types of areas you're working on a lot. But when we're thinking back in services and technology, the first phase of that was using technology and service operations, not customer facing. So we had computers in the 50s and 60s moving into record keeping and, of course, other areas then too. So that was the first phase. The second phase was the self-service technology, and we've come a long way from ATMs. So we now have food order kiosks in McDonald's and elsewhere. We've got airline check-in kiosks, so self-service technology online as well has come a long way. And of course, our very own center has played some role in the research around that. Mary Jo Bittner and others working on self-service technology and things. So so that brings us to maybe the mid-90s when you were starting to work on these topics. And so the first topic you were working on, you said mobile and digital services. Let's talk about that area a little bit more as to what your thoughts were then and how it has developed.
Yeah, that sort of started maybe latter part of the 90s. At the time, we had these text-based mobile interfaces, and I remember that I was using them, and they were mostly bad. They're bad or horrible, and as a user experience. And I remember that something must be done on that, and that was a spark to do my PhD. So actually, I started to work on a topic to understand how we can design services, more specifically mobile services, better, and that was sort of my starting point. Since that, of course, we had touchscreen user interfaces, Apple changed in the market, and more services are becoming sort of platform-based services. Today, I took an Uber to come here, and works brilliantly. It's a nice experience, all in all. And these were the things that I remember that when I was doing my master's thesis research, I was trying out this one interviewing technique, which is based on a theory called personal constructs that tries to understand how people see the world, what sort of mental models there are. Like if you go to the supermarket here, you will know where the groceries and, you know, the green stuff is and where you find the milk and so forth. Same thing, same supermarket will be in Finland, in Sweden, in Germany, and so forth. And on those terms, I want to try something out with you. Are you prepared to be a guinea pig
I'll be a guinea pig.
Okay. Sure, so like I said, I used this technique for my thesis study back home, and we were trying to figure out financial applications for third generation mobile phones at the time. And some of the ideas, I'll come back to you in a moment. Don't be nervous. It's going to be very easy. I remember that I was interviewing people at the time, and people were saying what they want. And one of the things we found out 2001 and 2002 was people want to do micropayments. For example, with the mobile phone, like Apple Pay today, something similar. They wanted to pay their bills using their phones, check their stock portfolios using their phones. All these things actually was not technically possible at the time. And it became possible maybe 2007, 2008. I saw first prototypes. And nowadays, this is regular life.
There's an interesting problem with how to discover customer requirements. They either want things like a flying car that you can't build, or they don't really know what they want because they don't have the imagination to think.
And here this interviewing technique come into the play, and I want to try this out. And we're not going to go to a major innovation talk here, but maybe it's just something simple like, Thomas, what would be your favorite juice? What sort of juice you like?
Orange juice.
Orange. Why do you like orange juice?
It's sweet and fresh.
Why does it need to be fresh or sweet?
Because compared to the other drink options, so like water or soda or things, it's nice sometimes to have something that feels more natural.
Okay. Why it's important it's natural?
Maybe that makes me think I'm being healthy.
Okay, high five. you succeeded. So this was the lettering interview in practice. So it sort of tries to understand, does it wants and needs what you have, and you want to be healthy. That's a good goal, and it's a very simple interviewing technique. But I have used this technique in 20-25 different projects with students and doing myself, maybe doing a couple of hundred of these interviews myself. And the power of the interviewing technique is that you're not going to be asking, okay, what do you want to have for your flying car? Because that's a difficult question to answer. Instead, you start to ask what sort of needs you might have. Why do you want to have that? Why is that important? Mm-hmm. And it starts sort of unravel the tacit part of our thinking. What is actually what are the wants that we have? And then the technology is not be limiting us, like with the financial application study. It took 10 years for the services to be used by us in the consumer space. So it has been really fun using this and trying to understand for needs, requirements, like we call them in IS, for different kinds of systems and services, and it has been really fun. And what's the nice thing is that typically these interviews are really fun to do as well, because people think about them, and at some point they figure out why I'm asking the why questions, and there's a big light bulb sort of lighting up, and it's good fun. So that's,
well, that's a good technique. Yeah. I mean, it's always especially in the service and technology area, it's such a struggle. I know from the industry side, when I worked in industry, and also from our center members, the industry members, such a struggle to really figure out, because again, they could say, oh, I want a flying car, goodbye, where's my flying car?
Yeah.
Or they could not imagine the things one could do and not really be helpful in that.
And that's that actually sort of characterizing my whole research career, that I have been trying to understand what are the important aspects of when you're trying to do this very innovative services, how you go about doing that, what kind of people you should be interviewing, how to sort of feed in that information that you get from the customers to the design and development, the innovation process. So that has been sort of one part.
There's another area that's relatively new in the industry side and starting to be picked up on the academy side, the whole notion of customer success management, which has a similar problem when I talk to industry people is, customer success, asking customers what is success is sometimes really hard for them to articulate what it means, that what they're really after, what kind of success they mean when they're trying to help customers being successful. Yeah, exactly. What does that mean? So it's sort of a similar problem.
Yeah. Related to that, in my research group, we have been studying, some of the people in the audience probably have heard about value co-creation. That has been a topic of our group for the last 3-4 years, try to understand, okay, if you're building, designing digital services, what are the key factors for the system point of view that enables actually these value creation activities between the service provider or the service system and the customer, and we have sort of come up with a few of them, like the context of use, social nature of use, but also the identity that the person might have using a system. And if you think about the simple sort of example is that if you think about, Thomas, your own email signature, you are telling quite a lot about yourself in your email signature. And that's one way of us, of course, building academic identity. Or if you think about Facebook or LinkedIn profiles, if people have a look on my LinkedIn profile, they will see quite a funny looking picture, but it's actually related to the research that I'm doing with this in the cyberspace.
Yeah, I remember that picture.
I recommend people having a look. I will put the link out in a moment. And then there are more familiar things for us service researchers, like service experience, the values and goals and people have, and participation in the service production. So these are sort of something that we have sort of tried to understand what might be the mechanisms between these elements, how we can enable things. But on the other side, there's also negative things happening in the service.
Co-destruction
of value. And that's something that I have a couple of students working on now. We're trying to understand what that actually means. And I have used sort of as an analogy a term, yin and yang, on this. And as you know, we have yin and yang. There's these two sides that are interacting. And that's a nice way of picturing it, because I more and more nowadays feel that if you really truly want to understand what value creation means for services, digital services especially, you need to understand how these co-creation and co-destruction sides work together. So you have things that are enabling value creation, and then you have things that are harming or lessening the value creation, which I use the term value co-destruction.
Yeah, one tool that we use here a lot in the center is the blueprinting tool, service blueprinting. And that always really helps when we work with companies. That always really helps companies to uncover that. And we have little stickers, red and green and yellow mm-hmm. stickers that help point out those points where value gets either co-created or value gets destroyed and co-destructed.
Exactly. And that has been really fun to sort of try to study. And mm-hmm. one of the studies my PhD student Julie Lintuna has been doing is on Pokemon Go. Mobile game. I don't know if you, Thomas, have you played Pokemon Go?
I haven't played it, but I've seen pictures that look interesting.
So Pokemon Go was one of these virtual reality AR, one of the biggest success stories in that. And nowadays, if you people ask people whether do you play Pokemon Go or not, people say no. But people still play, we found out. Mm-hmm. And then we started to get curious, why is that so that you don't admit that you play? Because it's not cool anymore. Mm-hmm. And we started to investigate what that might mean, and from the point of view of this value co-destruction for the between the service provider and the customer here, and we found out quite interesting things. And I remember this one anecdote that Julie told me from the research, which was quite revealing, I think. She was interviewing with this young mother. And she told us a story that she was out with her child with the baby carriage, and she was playing the game, and she fell. Mm-hmm. Okay, Thomas, what do you think that was the first thought that comes to her mind when she fell?
Well, I mine would, if the baby is safe and all that, but her might have been, is the game still working or something?
No, actually, my first thought was, did I hurt my knee? is my phone broken? Or something like that, but or of course then if the baby is okay, and the baby of course was fine, there was nothing that, but her first thought was, did somebody see that I was playing when I was out with my baby, mm-hmm. which bad mother, mm-hmm. and we sort of start finding out these tacit things that you. Mm-hmm. It's very difficult to ask, and that has brought us a little bit further understanding what. This value co-destruction actually means
conspicuous consumption element of technology. Where nowadays you see people. I was just watching last night. I was watching the movie The Two Popes. I don't know if you've seen it yet.
Not yet.
It was really funny because the I don't know if in real life it also happened, but in the film at least the Pope had one of those Fitbits or something on mm-hmm. there. And the Fitbit just talked to him while he was walking around. You haven't reached your 10,000 steps yet and things, right? This idea that technology becomes so ubiquitous that in terms of the services and what it provides, people are exposed in their ways of what you're doing. So you see the Pope walking around and he sat down and just talked, and all of a sudden the Fitbit starts, don't stop now, keep walking. This is really funny.
So the technology is really sort of impacting the way that we live.
Right.
In a way, yeah.
It's that nature. So certainly on the technology side, the possibility of the technology, when we're looking at services and inserting technology, the technology could be co-creating or co-destroying value as well, and how we think about that.
Yeah, that's true.
Those are everything. Let's check again in with the audience, and I'll check in with Denise if there are any questions. Denise, please go ahead.
Yes. So related to this discussion, multifaceted question. One question I have for you is, me personally, in talking about value, co-destruction, co-creation around services, how does trust come into that space in terms of now we're essentially trusting without any real choice or autonomy in some cases? How have you seen that particular thing evolving? Well,
that's an excellent question. Trust, in information system, we have studied e-commerce a lot, you know, a couple of decades of research. And one of the key aspects of us doing, purchases online is trust. And that has been sort of a major element there, I haven't seen that much popping up in the co-creation discussion yet. I don't know if Thomas, you have noticed that, but I happened to actually present a paper last week at the Higgs conference that I was pinpointing that based on our we did a quite extensive literature study with another student of mine, Mengxing Li, that trust seems to be popping up as one of the elements that is impacting both value co-creation and co-destruction. And that's something that we will look into more. But like I said, within the information systems research domain, with system use, trust has been definitely one key factor there. And we will go back to that later and see what sort of help we might get from that aspect. So the answer is yes and no, but it's certainly a really interesting topic that, like I said, I was presenting a paper on this last week. So
also
really cool question.
Yeah, also an important element of the services that are doing pay-per-use or pay-per-usage.
Yeah.
As examples, you know, the audience here probably all familiar with those examples, but I'll just use them. So the airline aircraft engine that is not bought but is paid by mile flown, or the Michelin tires that are not bought but paid by mile driven, or other areas, and then you have to have trust in the technology to correctly communicate the usage, because before it was easy. Here's money, I get a tire.
That was
easy. I needed to have trust that the tire was correctly produced, but I didn't need trust in the service part. It's just, here's money, I get a tire. Now I need to know, well, are you correctly charging me? Did I really drive that much? And all the things that are now baked into the services that require trust.
Exactly, yeah.
So that's an interesting, it's all enabled by technology, of course. There's no whole new pay-per-use and pay-per-usage. And we've got a number of our center member firms that are heavily working in that area and trying to figure that out.
And of course, that changes the way of doing business completely almost.
Right. Yeah. It's completely new service business models. We've got, I know some of our center members as well are working or trying to redesign their service business models. And that's part of it, driven by technology, because technology now enables you to do business models that simply weren't possible before. We could not have had a Michelin tire by mile driven, because you would have had to have an enormous field service organization checking everybody's mileage all the time to charge them.
That but now we can have sensors that tell us the data.
So very, very interesting area as well for the center and in research, in technology in particular, the whole question of business model. Actually, there's this term, everything as a service, or XaaS. Right? That's one of the newer terms.
Okay, that covers everything.
I've been asked to talk about with our members is the notion that you have software as a service. That's kind of where it started. The SaaS, software as a service, and then they have all kinds of AAS that I've seen. And now it's just XaaS. Yeah. Everything's a service. to academics in the audience, of course, the whole notion of the service dominant logic comes to mind. Whether or not that's helpful or not for the industry side is interesting too, right? At what point do we have no longer the answers, and what do we need to do as academics to help them to find the right answers?
Yeah.
Let's talk a little bit about that technology and services side. You mentioned the service platform. You came by Uber.
Yeah.
what do you think of those platform models? Are those, they certainly have a lot of consequences for not just for the research or for the company industry, but also for society and how technology plays a role in that.
Yeah, definitely it has been, you can just open any newspaper nowadays and sort of you start reading about the impact of platform-based business to our everyday life and how people are working differently, or even have work places to work that are sort of platforms.
Or the WeWork.
Yeah, for example.
Platform, yeah.
So it's definitely changing the way of doing. But what I have been sort of that's highly important. But what I have been sort of mostly in the recent couple of years looking at is something that you mentioned about these tires and sensors and sort of things, which I actually call sort of cyber-physical services. And Thomas, would you mind if I tell a little bit about
want to talk about the evolution and the future of services and technology, kind of what is next?
Yeah.
So let's start with what you're working on right now.
Okay. So I have a little slideshow prep, 2-3 slides. I'll try to be quick. I just see that time is sort of flying by, having fun with you guys. There's something that my group is working on. We call it continuous cyber-physical service innovations. And Basically, it's sort of recognizing where we are at the moment, and you can.
That's a good movie too.
Yeah, yeah. There's clips from Minority Report there. If somebody has not seen it yet, you should. It's a nice picture from 2002 with some good actors on it, and we can see the sort of see automated cars there. We have different kind of user interfaces that people are using.
I like the scene in the bottom right that we just had with the. Automatically adapting advertisements you walk through with facial recognition. In this case, they actually do the retina scan, eye scan.
Exactly.
But we have the facial recognition technology now that you could do that.
You have that in your phone.
Yeah.
Nowadays, so it's very close to by, and these things have been sort of inspiration as well. We're not going to do science fiction, but sort of see what could be the sort of everyday applications of such things. And I call this cybernization. Society, so we'll have these services that have a strong digital element, but also a very very physical element as well. Mm-hmm. And sort of the basis for this is this cyber-physical systems that are enabling this. These are social technical systems with a lot of sensors, with a lot of analytics, artificial intelligence built in, and one example from everyday life: Amazon Go store. Something that is you can go and visit. You need a mobile phone. You need an Amazon account. You scan your phone on your way in. You walk into the store. You pick up your things that you want to buy. Put it in a bag. Walk out. Bling. You get a credit card invoice as you go along. And of course, these things are enabled by a lot of sensors, a lot of cameras, a lot of artificial intelligence. Mm-hmm. So this is sort of practical. Example of cyber-physical service innovation.
I haven't had a chance to go to one.
Oh, you have?
I definitely want to now.
Yeah, yeah, I haven't either, but I really want to do that in the next few weeks, I hope. So that's sort of where we are at the moment. What we want to study with firms, and this is something that we actually doing together with the center here. So we are trying to figure out how to sort of help the companies to innovate these kind of new kinds of services better by understanding the problems that they have, mm-hmm. providing them tools, methods to support them, and also look at perhaps a little bit on the business model side, how to sort of put these things in action mm-hmm. as well. And this is a 3-year project that we are running. We got a major research grant back in Finland for this. And the idea is that we'll try to get maybe 4 to 5 companies in each country to sort of be involved, be partners in the project, and try to sort of figure out how we can help them to be better in that way. Of course, we want to learn what they are doing as well. But this is something that I'm super excited mm-hmm. because we are going to the Back to the Future as well. Another nice movie to watch.
Not the Back to the Future rather than the Minority Report. I'm good with that first one. Yeah, we'll go get the DeLorean. I'd like the DeLorean if you can put that into the grand.
I'll try to tweak that in. Yeah. Okay. And there's a link, my LinkedIn account, if somebody wants to connect with me, I'm more than happy to do that. And there's, if you Google us up, you can find our research group. And on my own web page, you can find a little more that I have been personally doing in the past few years.
Oh, that's great. So yeah, and we're excited to be partnering with you on that research. It's certainly an area, the whole cyber physical systems, so mm-hmm. where we bring the physical, like the Amazon Go store, the physical elements and the mm-hmm. cyber elements together. Is one that I know for our industry members in the center is also of high interest. And there's a number of companies that are really interested in that space mm-hmm. and working on that space. So we were very excited to join with mm-hmm. you in this research. And you said there's a grant, that part of the grant was to work with industry here, right? So that's what we talked about earlier.
Exactly. Yeah. That's the whole key that we'll be working with real companies.
That's the requirement of
with real
heading,
problems.
Right?
Yeah.
So that's again, coming back to that earlier discussion we've had, where in Europe that's just not only part of the normal way of doing things, but it's actually a requirement of in grants and just a very different interaction. And so, of course, with the center here, we are better positioned than many other places in the U.S. On the academic side to do that. We have done that for a long time, but it's that model that's just so ubiquitous in Europe, and that's really nice.
Thank
That's
you.
really cool. So that's and we'll be just for our industry board members, we will be reaching out to the board for participation in the study. In fact, Ture will be with us at the symposium and board meeting April 1, 2, 3.
Yes.
So we'll have our symposium and board meeting April 1st starts, and then through April 3, and Ture will be with us for that. So the board members will have a chance to talk to Ture a little bit more about all your wonderful research you've already done, and certainly this project as well.
Yeah, and I'll be in Arizona for a couple of weeks during the time, so there's a lot of opportunities if people have time outside of the meeting as well, so.
Great. Yeah. So now Ture loves the weather here.
Oh
That's
yeah, and the people.
if you're
It's
from Finland, it's a pretty nice to be here now.
Well, yeah, it's not bad at all. It's not bad at all.
That's for sure. I'm originally from Germany, not quite as wintry, and well, you guys win a lot of Winter Olympics medals, so that's you have the added advantage.
We have that opportunity, yes.
Lots of training opportunity, that's for sure. Let's check again with Denise for questions from the audience. Denise, please go ahead.
Okay, so this question is from, I want to mention your student that you mentioned, Meng Cheng Li. He says, thank you, professor. And he wonders, or she wonders, if you have any advice for choosing journals to submit in the area of information systems for PhD students. This is for our scholarly audience here.
Well, that's a thank you for that. It's a very sort of discipline specific question. So it really depends on which field you are doing your PhD. Certainly, we have service-oriented journals, like I mentioned, JSR, Service Research Journal, Service
Yeah,
Management.
I'd be remiss if I didn't say please publish in JSR. So send all your work to JSR.
And I've been actually been part of JSR for many years as an AE. Wonderful journal to be involved with. But then again, you can also find if you Meng Cheng was asking about information systems specifically. So there's certainly a lot of top-tier journals that are publishing service-oriented journals, from the MIS Quarterly to Journal of AIS and many others. So there's lots of opportunities. Not all journals might not be so eager, but I at least see in the top five, six journals you can see service-oriented publications. And in our conferences, we have dedicated tracks to service-oriented research. So
That's
I've
great.
been sort of doing that in Europe. I established
In the
service.
information systems
Yes,
conferences.
yes. So we established a service research track 5, 6 years ago, and it's running nicely. I run a track at the International Conference on IS, which is our flagship journal, flagship conference for 2 years, back to back. So there's a lot of definitely a lot of paper opportunities.
Maybe an encouragement to our service researchers to go into the non-marketing type conferences like those. There's one that you've just been at, which is HICS,
Yes, and that's a
which
really
the
nice.
HI stands for Hawaii. Every early January, this conference is in Hawaii. That's not a bad place to be either.
No, it's and it's a very cross-disciplinary conference. So you have your service resources, operations resource operations people. You have IS people. Yes, marketing professors. They actually I published the paper there with the professor of sales, Petri Parvinen. Thank you, Petri, for that. And you have your computer science people. You have your software engineering people. 1,100 people from different disciplines. So it's a very although it's a nice environment, I actually go for the substance, which is the cross-disciplinary nature of the conference. That sort of keeps me going there.
That's a great question, leading into sort of our next section, where we want to talk about the future a little bit, and sort of the notion of for both the academics and the businesses, where we're going next. And we'll start with the academics and staying on that path here for a second. What message do you have for service academics? What are things to look out for? Pitfalls, tips, tricks, things they collectively should work on?
Yeah, that's a really, really
Another easy question.
another easy, excellent question. But I thought about this. Thank you for providing me these difficult questions beforehand, so I could have a look on this. But I was thinking about this, and one sort of aspect came to my mind is that the importance of this cross-disciplinary research for our field. And like you mentioned, this center has been very sort of welcoming for me and others who are not coming from marketing, but some other disciplinary backgrounds. And I feel that this is also very important for this whole community as well. So we really sort of need to support this. I like I mentioned several times, JSR has been really doing a great effort on that. And that's, I think, one thing. Another thing that I was sort of thinking that might be interesting and a little bit out of the box for service, especially marketing professors like you, Thomas, mm-hmm. That in our field, I have been working on designing and developing different kinds of artifact systems or digital services. And we call this just a constructive style of research. We call that design science research. Mm-hmm. So we are actually designing things, and with the design, we try to integrate theories there and test some ideas, how they actually work in practice. And this could be interesting on a wider set of things for service researchers. Think about how they could do this design, you know, integrate designing service artifacts to their research, and that way try to create new knowledge and generalizable knowledge and theorizing mm-hmm. things. And there's a couple of nice papers published in the JSR mm-hmm. Using this style. A recent paper which just came out online is, I'll have to look at the title of the paper. It's called Trajectory Touchpoint Technique, TTTT, which happens to be also my initials. My full name is Teotura Tuononen, so it's some paper that sort of it sort of jumped out at me.
You have to read this.
and it's a fascinating paper developing a new service design method. So the artifact here is the method for designing things. And the paper is set and the study is set in hospice care. So it's a really sort of untypical area of doing mm-hmm. research. And I remember reading the paper a few weeks back, and the authors say that with the help of this new service design method, they were able to design the service so that helped 80 people to die in a way that they wanted. Mm-hmm. And that really struck me as it's a very powerful statement. And there are other papers published there. I actually happened to publish another paper about doing this kind of research with Leo Patricio and George Teixeira. That was in Journal Service Management. If somebody is interested to have a look or to send me an email, I'm more than happy to share a copy on that.
Transformative service research, exactly. Which would be another whole conversation.
Exactly, that's another day.
But let's move to the business world.
Yeah.
What are some things that businesses should learn more about and pay more attention to from what we know in the academy?
Well, yeah, that's another easy question to answer.
Just easy question.
and I don't want to sound like know-it-all. I'm a primarily academic, although I do have some firms of my own at the moment. But when I talk with
you have to talk to yourself, right?
So yeah, I'm sort of
your business hat with your entrepreneurial
changing hats. Yeah, but talking with the sort of research clients that I have to the businesses. Typically, they are really interested in the things that we're doing, but they don't always sort of have the time to follow through what's going on in academia, especially when we are looking at this process development stuff that we have been working on, like the recent paper with the TTTT paper. It takes a while to sort of think, okay, how could I apply this in my own work? And for that reason, I sort of see that what businesses are doing is not—it's typically lacking behind mm-hmm. a little bit. And some people, businesses are more innovative. Some are not. And on average, it's sort of there's some kind of a lag time. I remember as an example of this. 20 years ago, this agile development mm-hmm. for innovation, especially in software area, started coming up. And a few companies started doing that already 20, 15 years ago. I actually was in a nice position to follow that through. And nowadays, if you talk with any IT companies that are doing software, they will tell that they do some version of agile development nowadays. And that sort of explains that it takes a long time to adapt new things.
Right.
And perhaps my key message to the board members and the business people listening today is that I mentioned about this continuous service innovation development processes. I'm not going to try to sell the idea too much, but I sort of see in a more sort of broad aspect that this development and operations style, continuous innovation style of integrating development operations daily base.
The DevOps.
Yeah, DevOps thing. Yeah, that is really sort of coming to be the next big paradigmic change. Mm-hmm. So from Agile, we are going moving towards this. And my sort of advice for the firms would be to start looking at this and sort of see how they might start adopting some aspects of this. You need to have a cultural change, like with Agile, within the organization to adopt it, use it properly, mm-hmm. and have value out of that. But now it's the time to start looking at this, because in 5-10 years, this is the way that firms will be doing, successful firms will be doing business.
That's my view.
Yeah,
that's great advice. Reach out. We talked about the cross-disciplinary, but also across from university and business,
yes.
So industry, university, corporation,
yes.
Like what we, of course, are very much doing here with the center and just do more of that and
exactly.
do it more continuously,
yes.
in a sense.
Yeah.
Now, I have three very easy questions for you at the end now.
These are getting easier and easier.
Easy questions for the end.
Yeah.
First question, if I could relive something from my career, it would be, these are the three ifs that we like to close our conversations with every guest. So
yeah.
These are the easy questions for the end.
Yeah.
If I could relive something from my career, it would be.
Yeah, I was thinking this hard, and I was going to say that actually I'm living the life that
everything
I want to live. Yeah, everything's actually great. But I was thinking this more in a way that perhaps not changing things, but looking at things. What was pretty remarkable aspects of my career. One was that when I was doing my PhD defense, which is totally opposite of what you do in US, that you have a seminar room, you have your advisors, the committee, and you have a conversation between them and small presentation. In Finland, you have an open defense with the public public place. I had 100 people in the audience. We had the opponent who really opposes your thesis. You have to defend your thesis, and that took for three hours, and that was quite an experience. And I also did a live TV interview with one of the major news channels in the morning of my PhD. That tells about the Finnish society quite a lot. I still see those interviews done in the TV, that they'll bring somebody, a young academic, to talk about their experiences. And that was for 10 minutes, so nice.
That's a pretty cool day.
Yeah.
Yeah, pretty cool day to go back
to.
Yeah.
Yeah. And since then, later on, some other highlights, sort of that memories, big memories, is that first Financial Times 50 publication, seeing the page numbers. That felt magical.
Real. It felt real.
And more recently, receiving your full professorship,
mm-hmm.
you know, something that I worked hard and many of us work hard towards that single goal. And now I'm a dean of research at my faculty. So I'll try to bring these same kind of memories to our students and junior faculty. And I hope that I succeed. I'm 2 weeks into the job, so.
Let's go.
So
far, so good. Let's go to the other side. If you could change something from your career,
yeah.
it would be.
And that was a tricky thing as well. Like I said, I'm happy where I am at the moment. I remember that when I was an assistant professor, I did think about one thing that I might have changed. Although I'd end up doing my PhD at Aalto University School of Business, which has an excellent program. So I got a really nice schooling on doing research. But I wanted to do an international career, I was planning to go outside of Finland as my first job anyway. I realized that maybe doing my PhD outside of my home country would have even given me more benefit, thinking about maybe UK or US or some of the Australian schools, for example, and Asian schools. And for a few years I thought that might be something to change. But then again, I ended up working in the University of Auckland Business School. I had really, really top of the line scholars there to work with, like Michael Myers, who became my close friend later on, and he's really one of the top guys in my field. I met Rod Brody, who sort of lured me back to the to the service field, which I'm so grateful for Rod. So I think everything worked out. So I don't know if that's I wanted to change anything in the end. It's you, like somebody has said, you have to make your own luck, that's yeah.
One more quick question. The last, if I had a magic wand, I would.
Oh yeah, that's makes me think. And my wife works in the Stockholm School of Economics, so I would take my magic wand, boof, and I will change the location of her school to Jyväskylä, so we would have a little bit short the commute to work. It might surprise a few Swedes and my rector as well. So, but with magic wand.
But you can do anything. Right.
So
that works out. Well, thank you so much. Thank you, Ture, for joining me on the webinar. Thank you, audience, for your questions and for joining us on the webinar. Thank you, Denise, for managing the questions as they came in. I hope to see you soon at one of the next CSL events. Have a great rest of your day and week.